Hi, I'm Torben Jansen from thoughtsonjava.org. As expected, the recent release of the JPA 2.2 specification introduced official support for some of the classes of the Date and Time API. Before that, you had to rely on proprietary features, like the ones introduced in Hibernate 5, which I showed you in one of my previous videos. Today I want to take a closer look at JPA's new support for the Date and Time API and compare it with Hibernate's proprietary implementation. Before we start, let's quickly talk about the dependencies you need to add to your project. The first Maven dependency here on the slide adds the API jar of the JPA 2.2 specification to your project. You can use it to implement your application, but you obviously need an implementation at runtime. You can use Eclipse Link 2.7 or Hibernate 5.2. After you've added the required dependencies, you can use some of the classes of the Date and Time API as entity attributes. The JPA 2.2 specification maps only the classes for which the appendix section B4 of the JDBC 4.2 specification defines a mapping. These are local date, local time, local date time, offset time, and offset date time. You might be surprised that this list includes offset time and offset date time, which store the offset of the local time zone to UTC. But JPA doesn't support zone date time, which stores additional time zone information like daylight saving time. Okay, let's get into the IDE and take a look at how to persist attributes of these types. JPA 2.2 supports the listed classes as basic types, and you don't need to provide any additional mapping information. That is one of the benefits of the Date and Time API. It uses separate classes to model date or date and time information. So your JPA implementation doesn't need any additional information to map the Java object to the correct JDBC type. Here you can see a simple example of such a mapping. The entity uses the auto strategy to generate the primary key value and persists attributes of type local date, local time, local date time, offset time, and offset date time. You can use these attributes in the same way as you use any other entity attribute. In this test case, I create a new entity and set the 5 attributes before I persist the entity. Then I commit the transaction and create a new entity manager before I create this JPQL query to read the new entity from the database. As you can see here, you can also use the attributes that map the classes of the Date and Time API in your query. Okay, let's run this test case and have a quick look at the generated SQL statements before we compare JPA's support for the Date and Time API with the one implemented in Hibernate 5. Here you can see the generated SQL statements. As expected, Hibernate mapped the 5 attributes to the corresponding database columns. Hibernate supports the classes of the Date and Time API since version 5 as basic types. And it not only supports the 5 mappings defined in the JPA 2.2 specification, it also maps duration, instant, and zone datetime objects. Here's a full list of the supported Java types and the JDBC types to which Hibernate maps them. The mapping of duration and instant are pretty obvious, but the mapping of zone datetime requires a more detailed explanation. Hibernate maps it to a JDBC timestamp without time zone information. So, what happens when you persist a zone datetime with Hibernate, and why does it not store the time zone information? Hibernate converts the zone datetime to the local time zone and stores it in the database without time zone information. Let's take a look at an example. This is almost the same project as I used before. I just replaced Eclipse Link with Hibernate 5.2.10 and added a zoned daytime attribute to the entity. My local time zone is Europe Berlin, which is UTC plus 2, and at the beginning of this test case, I'm getting the current time in UTC and then persist that zoned daytime object with Hibernate. So let's see what happens when I run this test case. As you can see here, the entity attribute is still a zoned daytime with the time zone UTC when Hibernate writes the bind parameters to the log file. But when you take a look at the record in the database, you can see that Hibernate didn't store the UTC time in the database. It converted the zoned daytime object to my local time zone. This approach works fine as long as all instances of your application use the same local time zone. But you will run into problems as soon as you change the time zone setting or your cluster gets out of sync. It's better to tell Hibernate which time zone it shall use. You can do that with the configuration parameter hibernate.jdbc.timezone, which you can set in the persistence.xml file or on the session factory. When you run the same test case with this configuration, Hibernate uses the UTC time zone to store the local daytime and the zoned daytime in the database. Here you can see the two timestamps that Hibernate persisted for the daytime and the zoned daytime attributes. Hibernate converted both of them to UTC before it stored them in the database. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like a cheat sheet for this video and an ebook about the Java 8 support in Hibernate 5. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!